Good morning. This is Tuesday, August 29th. I'm Harry Smith.
And I'm Faith Daniels, in for Kathleen Sullivan, who's on vacation. Welcome to CBS This Morning.
Good morning, Faith.
Good morning.
Good to see you again. We've been paying a lot of attention to Colombia's battle against the cocaine cartel, but the drug trade knows no borders. Cocaine grown and processed in Colombia becomes crack, poisons our kids, and adds to the violence on the streets of American cities. Now, Colombia is fighting back with U.S. help and the courage of its own people. In a few minutes, we'll hear from a Colombian civic leader who travels with armed guards under the constant threat of assassination. In this country, Chicago has a reputation of being the most crack-free of our major cities. Now there are reports that that might be changing, too. We'll talk with the head of Chicago Police Department's narcotics unit.
Also this morning, there is a new tradition at the University of Texas. No drinking during rush week when frats pick their new members. It comes after two of the nation's largest fraternities called for dry rush weeks and other reforms. Two Texas students will be with us to talk about the change. We'll also hear more of my conversation with Paul McCartney this morning. His wife Linda will be joining in. And Lorenzo Lamas of Falcon Crest will be with us this morning. We begin, though, as always, with the news. And here with that this morning is Barry Peterson. Good morning, Barry.
Good morning, Faith and Harry, and good morning to all of you. The bombers are back at work this morning in Bogota and Medellin, Colombia. At least one bomb went off before dawn in the capital, and at least half a dozen others in Medellin. So far, no word on casualties. Colombia's president says it's not the people in his country who grow the cocaine that made this war. He says it's the people in America and other countries who use it. But as Juan Vasquez reports from Bogota, the government is keeping up the pressure.
Colombian drug fighters seized another alleged cocaine trafficker as the nationwide manhunt for leaders of the drug cartel continued. Colombian sources claimed Abraham Mahut is a well-known figure in the cocaine business, although he is not on Washington's most wanted list. Colombian Justice Minister Monica de Grief met with U.S. Attorney General Richard Thornburg in Washington to discuss cooperation in the fight against drug traffickers. Today, Thornburg will make a full report on the Colombian problem to President Bush. Meanwhile, the president of Colombia appealed to the international community to help in the battle against cocaine.
The narco-traffickers must come to understand that they are taking on all of you when they attack us, that we are not fighting them alone.
In Medellin, the Colombian drug capital, extra police are on the way to prevent more violence. It has been the scene of several bombings and fires since the most recent crackdown began. The transfer of alleged drug cartel money launderer Eduardo Martinez Romero to the United States could be imminent. His extradition papers are in Bogota waiting to be signed. Colombians fear the move could trigger a round of violence even worse than what Medellin has experienced in the last few days. Juan Vasquez, CBS News, Bogota.
As Juan reported, President Bush is taking a work break from his vacation today for a cabinet-level skull session on the anti-drug campaign. Jacqueline Adams joins us now from the president's home near Kennebunkport, Maine. Jackie, good morning.
Good morning, Barry. As you said, President Bush will put his total vacation on hold for a few hours today. By mid-morning, his top drug policy advisors will arrive to put the finishing touches on the comprehensive $8 billion anti-drug strategy he'll announce a week from today in his first primetime Oval Office address. The scope of the package is evident from the list of participants: the director of the CIA, the defense secretary, the attorney general, a deputy secretary of state, perhaps the budget director, and of course, the drug policy advisor. The White House is putting the focus on the demand side of the problem, building more prisons, putting the heat on the crack smokers and the cocaine sniffers whom they blame, as well as the president of Colombia blames, for this national crisis. But because the White House also sees this as a national security threat, there'll be a $250 million allocation to help the drug-producing countries do battle with their own cocaine cartels. Barry?
Jackie, is that money in addition to the $65 million that's already been allocated?
Yes, it is. Peru and Bolivia are said to have cocaine-producing problems almost as severe as those in Colombia. And because now the Colombian government is beefing up its war against the cartels, there's a fear that they'll move their bases of operation to other countries in Central and Latin America.
Jackie, thank you very much. Jacqueline Adams with the president in Kennebunkport. Off Beirut this morning, a Lebanese tanker hit by Syrian artillery and set afire. The ship had tried to run Syria's naval blockade to bring desperately needed fuel to Lebanon's Christian. 9 crewmen are missing, presumed dead. 2 rescued while Christians opened fire on the Syrian positions. The artillery duel there killed 3 people. A rare public disagreement has erupted between Solidarity and Poland's Catholic leader. It concerns a Catholic convent on the grounds of the Nazi death camp at Auschwitz. On Saturday, Joseph Cardinal Glimp said Jews in other countries were violating Poland's sovereignty by demanding the removal of the convent. Several Jewish groups have said Auschwitz is no place for a convent because it's a symbol of Jewish suffering. Today's Solidarity newspaper condemns Glimp's remarks. It says they could be painful to Holocaust survivors. Jurors in the Jim Bakker trial are getting 2 very different pictures of the TV preacher. Bakker's attorneys are portraying the former head of the PTL ministry as a religious fundraising genius. But prosecutors said in their opening statements that Bakker was driven by greed and deception and cheated his followers. While Bakker was in court, his wife Tammy appeared on their television show and told her husband to keep the faith.
Don't give up, honey. We're on the brink of a miracle, and God is going to outlast our storm.
If Bakker is convicted, he could get 120 years in prison. Former Georgia Congressman Pat Swindall continues to proclaim his innocence despite his sentencing yesterday for perjury. Swindall was sentenced to a year in jail and was fined more than $30,000 for lying to a grand jury investigating a money laundering scheme. Swindall remains free pending appeal. Congressman Barney Frank wants the House Ethics Committee to investigate his hiring of a male prostitute as his personal assistant. Frank admits he hired Stephen Gobi to run errands and do household chores, but Frank denies knowing that his Washington home was being used by Gobi to sell sex.
If I was in on it all along, why did I fire him? Why did I not only tell him not to use my house, but say, I don't want to have any more to do with you. You have betrayed me, and I am angry at you, and that's the end of it. Why did I break it off that way? And I don't think there's a plausible explanation for that.
House Democrats have been under pressure to call for an investigation of the incident. By requesting the ethics probe himself, Frank takes the heat off his colleagues. The spotlight on the Shuttle Atlantis this morning at the Kennedy Space Center. NASA rolled out Atlantis before dawn, beginning the final stage of preparation for a planned October launch. Inside the shuttle's payload bay is the most sophisticated interplanetary spacecraft ever built, the Galileo probe to Jupiter. Trading opens on Wall Street this morning with the Dow Industrials coming off another record high. Stock prices climbed 11 points yesterday to close above 27.43. In Tokyo this morning, stock prices up slightly, and in European trading, the dollar is down. In London, gold unchanged at $360 an ounce, silver up 2 cents to $5.11. This will be a bad day for some big guys. About 24 pro football players, the NFL plans to suspend them for 30 days for using steroids. The Players Association asked a federal judge in Washington to block the suspensions, but the judge ruled the players were given plenty of notice that using the muscle-building drugs would result in disciplinary action. Politicians, you know, used to get by just by kissing babies. But at the current Minnesota State Fair, Lieutenant Governor Marlene Johnson has had her hands full, in this case, peeling apples to beat the ban. In case you're wondering, she won the contest. In the past few days, Johnson's also has taken part in a cow milking contest and a wild rice cook-off, and today, I'd say, she's probably betting, or hoping, rather, for a rainout. All right, Faith and Harry, aren't you glad you're not running for office?
Well, the hog calling contest is coming up one of these days.
Oh, no.
Get out there for that, Harry. Come on, stay fair time in real America.
Yeah, and we'll find out if it's going to be rained out. Here's Mark McEwen with the weather. Good morning, Mark.
Good morning, Faith. Good morning, Harry. Good morning, everyone out there, hog callers included. Let's talk about the weather. 69 degrees in New York City. I've said it before, I'll say it again. It's sort of an Edgar Allan Poe kind of morning, dreary, gloomy, quote the raven, et cetera, et cetera. Rain off the coast of New Jersey, also some rain coming into Pennsylvania and southern New York. Pay the toll at the Pennsylvania Turnpike, heading our direction. Down in the south, I want to put this here because it's Labor Day weekend coming up, but guess what happens after Labor Day, gang? That's right. Back to school. I'm just going to remind you, I don't want to ruin your weekend. I used to love going to schools like an audience. Get in there and say, so, where are you from? Which is beautiful. 80 down in Miami. You can see it's raining around the Kansas City area and also some thunderstorms coming across portions of Nebraska, Oklahoma, and Texas. Kind of cool in Chicago, 70 degrees right now, which they're waking up to. It's not too bad. Down the southwest, 79 in Phoenix. Also, you can see 71 degrees over there in Las Vegas. Up and down the west coast, basically sunshine. Little cloud activity, as you can see, up here in portions of Idaho, maybe parts of eastern Oregon as well. 51 in Anchorage and raining, and 54 degrees and cloudy in Fairbanks, and 74 in Lovely in Honolulu. We've got baseball to talk about. Take a look at this. We've got a game today. Yes, Houston Astros at the Chicago Cubs. Game time, 2 o'clock. Cloudy skies, temperatures in the 70s. There's more. A doubleheader, the Angels versus Boston. That begins at 5. Possible showers at game time. Temperatures will be in right around 80 degrees. That's a quick look at the national forecast. Let's take a look at your weather.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Tim Kelly in the Channel 6 Weather Center. We're going to have a gray day today. A couple of glimpses of sunshine. Also some showers scattered about, 74 to 78. Tomorrow we see the sun return during the afternoon.
Next time, a wake-up call for Raleigh, North Carolina.
Carla Lopez Obregon is a Colombian politician who has criticized the drug lords. Now she has to wear a bulletproof vest and drive through Bogota in an armored car with police and private bodyguards. Death threats are frequent. Lopez is a human rights activist and a liberal candidate for Senate, and she joins us this morning from Bogota. Good morning.
Very good morning.
When did you start wearing a bulletproof vest? When did you find that you needed bodyguards just to go about your daily business?
That would be about January of 1987, when the first threat I received was a material threat with a motorcyclist aiming a machine gun at me. Since then, I have been surrounded by a big group of bodyguards. I've been in an armored car and have to wear a bulletproof vest permanently, even in the office when I am attending the public.
What other kinds of threats have you received since then?
Later, the attorney general who was assassinated, Dr. Carlos Mauro Hoyos, informed me that I had appeared in one of the death lists that circulated about a year and a half ago. And many of the people in that list today have been hit.
What is that like for you on a day-by-day basis to know that you are that close to that, your life is in that much danger?
Well, in the first place, I never felt that important. But the reality of the situation is that one cannot have a normal personal life. No going to the movies, no going to restaurants. And a very, very heavy part of it goes to the family. My mother, who is rather old, is always very worried. And I have great family pressures, even to leave my work in politics.
The government has declared war on these drug lords in Colombia. Do you think that that war is winnable?
I think that it is winnable, and that the change in course in government policy is very important, because this comes after 3 or 4 years of absolute violence and over 1,000 political assassinations. But to be winnable, the government has to take further action. It has to realize that in conjunction with the warlords, with the drug lords, there are people involved inside of government, inside authority, inside the armed forces. And it has to, the government has to take a very definite action in that sphere to depure the army, to purify it of those people that are in alliance with the criminals that the government and society is hoping to be able to take to justice.
So it's your sense then that it's because of bribes and cooperation of members of the military and even members of the government that the drug lords have been able to get such a firm hold on the Colombian countryside?
Yes, it has a double edge. It is a corruption through money and an ideological aspect. There is a nucleus of fascistic elements within the armed forces that have found ideology as part of the alliance that they have reached with the drug lords in the persecution of the inconformity in Colombia, both social and political inconformity, as is demonstrated by the fact that most of the assassinations that have taken place have been directed towards labor leaders, opposition political leaders, as well as human rights activists and grassroots organizers.
The United States is giving $65 million in military aid to Colombia. Is that going to make a difference?
I think that the material aid is very important. There's no question that our armed forces need material aid. I am definitely not in agreement with any further collaboration with sending advisors or sending troops, because that would enter into deepening the conflict inside of Colombia, even bringing it to the edge of the East-West conflict, which the world is coming to overcome.
Hundreds of judges have quit in the last several days. The judicial system is hanging by a thread. You live in constant threat of death. Will you stay on? Will you back down?
I think that I am, as a lot of people in Colombia, in the process of keeping our faith in the future of the country and indefinitely working to aid the government in its efforts and to aid society in what has to be a triumph in this war, because Colombia cannot continue living in this bloodbath.
Clara Lopez, we thank you so much for joining us. Do take care.
Thank you very much, and good morning.
Faith?
Harry, it's now 16 after the hour. Next, the drug trade hits home. Crack comes to Chicago. And later, Texas fraternities say no to alcohol during rush week. Cocaine exported from Colombia too often winds up on the streets of American cities in the deadly form of crack. The crack plague has already swept into many of the nation's largest cities: New York, Detroit, Washington, Dallas, L.A., and San Francisco, now Chicago. The Chicago Tribune reports that crack has found a toehold in that city and moved into several surrounding suburbs. Raymond Risley is the commander of the narcotics section of the Chicago Police Department, and he is with us live from Chicago this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Has crack broken the barrier into Chicago?
No, it hasn't. The Tribune article, unfortunately for us, had a very sensationalistic headline. But for those who read that article in total, it reported that that crack is used widely in some of our more poor suburbs in Chicago, or in the Chicago area, but it has not yet taken a toehold in Chicago, and we're very enthusiastic about the fact that we do not have a crack epidemic in Chicago.
The headline that you refer to simply says crack has broken the barrier in Chicago. That doesn't seem all that sensational unless it is untrue, and you're saying it's untrue? There is no crack in Chicago?
No, I'm saying that we do not have a crack epidemic in Chicago. I'm saying that the headline is quite misleading. Clearly, there is crack in every major city in the United States, but we have to differentiate between whether or not crack is present and we're having a crack epidemic. We are, in fact, not experiencing a crack epidemic here, and we're very proud of the fact that we're not.
How is it, when all major cities in the country have been targeted early on, that Chicago has really been, as you say, sort of immune to an epidemic?
Well, I believe a combination of factors are at play here. Clearly, we benefited from the fact that crack epidemics were experienced along our eastern coastal cities. First, the drug-using community, I think, benefited from the media coverage of the crack epidemic in New York. Clearly, their drug-using habits have been moderated by the information that they were provided, and particularly the information about the violent nature of crack use.
So what are you doing in Chicago, then, to combat the problem and keep it from becoming an epidemic?
Well, we've done a couple things. Mid-May of 1988, we identified one large-scale crack manufacturer and distribution organization on the city's near south side. We conducted a very aggressive and energetic investigation into that organization and arrested every member thereof. They've all been prosecuted at the federal level. To date, everyone in that organization but two have been convicted. Those two remaining have yet to go on trial. That's the first thing. Secondly, we established a crack cocaine task force in the narcotics section of the Chicago Police Department. And we review all case reports involving the recovery of crack or cocaine-like substances and identify where crack is being recovered anywhere in the city. Once we do that, we send individuals out, undercover officers out, identify the locations where crack is being used and or sold, and arrest the individuals who are responsible. That information is that activity has resulted in good intelligence information for us, which reveals that there are no additional large-scale crack manufacturing distribution organizations in the city of Chicago. What we're experiencing is the manufacture of crack by individual entrepreneurs who are making the substance for their use or for the use of friends, and in some cases for sale. However, the fact remains that we don't have a large-scale crack manufacturing and distribution organization, and as long as we're able to keep that from occurring, we're going to avoid a crack epidemic.
Well, certainly that would be good news. Commander Raymond Risley, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
It's now 22 after the hour. Harry?
And still ahead, Paul McCartney, ready for a sold-out tour. Back to CBS This Morning. I'm Harry Smith.
I'm Faith Daniels, in for Kathleen Sullivan.
And I'm Mark McEwen.
Believe it or not, 50 years ago this week, Adolf Hitler launched his blitzkrieg on Poland, beginning World War II. In just a few minutes, we'll look back at how Hitler amassed the political power to lead his country into Poland. We will also go live to Austin, Texas this half hour. Students at the University of Texas have sworn off a time-honored but potentially dangerous tradition, drinking during fraternity rush week.
And dangerous cribs have been blamed for the deaths and injuries of a number of infants. Aaron Moriarty is going to be here with what the crib industry says it's doing about the problem and what the government says it cannot do about it. And how fast did the tickets go for the American concerts on Paul McCartney's upcoming tour in Los Angeles alone? Five shows, almost 80,000 tickets were sold out in 60 minutes. This half hour, more of Faith's visit with Paul and Linda McCartney. Now, Victoria Corderi has this morning's news. Good morning, Vicki.
Actually, Harry, it's Barry. Sorry about that. Victoria is off on assignment this morning, so. Good morning to all of you. The drug lords are boosting the pressure in Colombia. Half a dozen more bombs exploded early this morning in Medellin, and at least one went off at a travel agency in Bogota, causing heavy damage. The travel agency is across the street from a military academy. No word so far on casualties. Colombia's president says the cocaine war that's tearing his country apart is the fault of drug users in the United States and elsewhere. But there's more to it than that. Earlier on CBS This Morning, a Colombian Senate candidate told Harry the war can only be won by rooting out government corruption.
The government has to take further action. It has to realize that in conjunction with the warlords, with the drug lords, there are people involved inside of government, inside authority, inside the armed forces. And it has to, the government has to take a very definite action in that sphere to depure the army, to purify it of those people that are in alliance with the criminals.
U.S. military options in the drug war are limited, but as David Martin reports from the Pentagon, the generals are making what plans they can to help the Colombians.
According to Pentagon officials, jungle airstrips and the small planes that use them to fly cocaine from South America to the U.S. will become major targets in the Bush administration's war on drugs. Under the plan being prepared for the president's announcement next month, the Pentagon would provide Colombia and other South American countries with the equipment, training, and intelligence to launch strikes against the air arm of the drug cartel.
They have to hit the cartel in their weakest point. And I believe that we can identify, along with the Colombian government, where these airfields are and go in there and strafe the planes and bomb the runway so that the planes cannot take off.
Despite high-tech equipment like the AWACS radar plane and the activation of a new command center in Key West, Florida, the military's present efforts to intercept drugs before they enter the U.S. are not working.
Well, so far they haven't been effective at all. They tell us that probably less than 5% of the cocaine and marijuana and heroin that comes across our border is interdicted by these paramilitary operations, or in total. And so it hasn't been very effective.
U.S. officials insist there are no plans to send American troops into combat against the cartel. But President Bush refused to rule in or out the possible use of covert action by the CIA.
If I discuss covert action, it wouldn't be covert. And I don't discuss that kind of thing at all anyway. So please don't take that answer as a yes or a no or a confirm or a deny.
There's been a lot of talk about going to the source of the drug trade, but Pentagon officials say helping other countries attack the cartel's airstrips is as close to the source as they plan to get. David Martin, CBS News, the Pentagon.
With NASA still basking in the glow of Voyager's spectacular success at Neptune, the space agency is now preparing to take aim at Jupiter. The space shuttle Atlantis rolled out to a Kennedy Space Center launch pad this morning for an October liftoff. On board the shuttle is Galileo, an unmanned spacecraft that will be fired off toward Jupiter. And if all goes well, Galileo will go into orbit around Jupiter, then drop a probe into the planet's stormy atmosphere. Televangelist Jim Bakker heads back to federal court in Charlotte, North Carolina this morning to defend himself against fraud charges. Prosecutors say Bakker bilked followers of more than $4 million, living a life of luxury, while his PTL ministry was on the edge of bankruptcy. Some of the people making news this morning. Former President Reagan got to strap himself into the cockpit of the super secret stealth bomber at Edwards Air Force Base. Mr. Reagan called the plane truly amazing and a key part of keeping the peace through strength. Singer Grace Slick says her group, the Jefferson Airplane, isn't like other bands from the 60s. Slick says most aging rock groups go on tour just for the money, but the Jefferson Airplane, she says, just likes making music. And Philadelphia fans outside JFK Stadium got a free, though distant, taste of another 60s band that's hitting the road again, the Rolling Stones. Just got to hear them in rehearsal, unfortunately. You know, Mick Jagger might say he just likes playing the music, but the pay isn't all that bad. It's $1 million a performance. About as much as a good weather forecast, right, Mark?
We paid that much, Barry. Thanks very much.
My new agent, Barry Peterson. You know, you never see people hanging outside of a Frank Sinatra concert, just kind of because they can't get in.
If they can't sing.
But they did it for the Stones. A little weather for $1 million. Let's take a walk over here and tell you. Yeah, this morning's weather segment is sponsored by New Sweet One low-calorie sweetener. It's the taste that's causing a stir. Look at that swing. Oh, gorgeous. Don Mattingly, except that's right-handed. Raleigh, North Carolina. We're waking them up this morning. It's partly cloudy and 70 degrees right now. And you're saying, Mark McEwen, why are we waking up Raleigh? Well, this weekend on the campus of Meredith College in Raleigh, the Great Pops Weekend gets underway. North Carolina Symphony will play on Sunday. Skydivers, fireworks, great food all weekend. WRALTB 5 is our affiliate out there. Let's do the weather. Bingo. Here we go. Well, it looked kind of bad this morning when we woke up in the Northeast. It's an overcast, muggy day in the Northeast. That's what you're going to see. And there will be plenty of the way of fog and showers throughout the afternoon. Sue me, right? I wish I had a better forecast, but you can see this right here on the map. There just doesn't seem to be any break in those thunderstorms across the Central Plains and the Midwest. I'm standing in front of them right now. There are those thunderstorms we were talking about. They continue to flare up and bring heavy rains from the areas of New Mexico up to Kansas and northward into Indiana and Illinois, all the way across here. Get out in front of the weather here, Mark. Bingo, there you can see it. Also looks like the sweltering heat will continue across the Deep South, as most places will be at least in the low 90s. Far Southwest will be sunny and seasonably warm. That is a quick look at the national forecast. Let's take a look at your weather.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Tim Kelly in the Channel 6 Weather Center. We're going to have a gray day today, a couple of glimpses of sunshine, also some showers scattered about, 74 to 78. Tomorrow we see the sun return during the afternoon.
Next time around, what we're going to do, we'll take a look at some of the rain activity around the country. Harry?
Thanks very much, Mark. It's not worth $1 million.
No, it's not. $750,000.
It's 23 minutes before the hour. And coming up next, Chris Matthews on Hitler's rise to power and the start of World War II 50 years ago.
This week, the world changed forever. German troops invaded Poland and World War II was underway. In 6 years as Chancellor, Adolf Hitler had rearmed Germany and launched a series of moves that put German soldiers in the Rhineland, then Austria, and Czechoslovakia. But when his troops moved into Poland, Britain and France declared war. a war that lasted 6 years and took 50 million lives before Germany was defeated. Political columnist Chris Matthews is with us this morning to look at how Hitler and Germany reached the brink and then crossed it. Good morning.
Good morning, Faith.
50 years ago this week, he invaded Poland, but the political war started long before that.
That's right, Faith. I think that this is a terrible anniversary, obviously. 50 million people were killed in World War II. And it was the Holocaust. It was the worst thing that has ever happened to mankind, probably. And it happened in the lifetime of many of the people watching today. I think it's important to remember what happened exactly. Hitler did not rise to power because he had better tanks than anyone else, although he did, or because he had the Wehrmacht or the Luftwaffe, his air force. He rose to power as a politician. He was very diabolic in the way he played the democracies of the world in his favor. He had nothing going for him in 1934 and 35. By 1939, he could create a world war. And he was able to get to that position because of his shrewd, evil politics. What he did was, he did three clever techniques that he used against the democracies, France and Britain. First of all, he always talked peace. When he rearmed and broke the Versailles Treaty, he gave a speech on peace. When he moved into the Rhineland, which was the demilitarized zone, and put himself in a position to attack France, he talked peace. He was always promising peace, always striking on a Saturday. He would have these Saturday surprises where he'd move, and then he'd say, let's have peace. And then it was up to the democracies to decide whether they wanted to start World War I all over again, which had only been 17 years before. And they always said, no, anything's better than war. The second thing he always did was create Germans as victims. He was always saying the Germans were being abused by the Versailles Treaty. They were being abused in Austria and later in Czechoslovakia. He was always claiming some measure of moral opportunity. The third thing he always did is he always carved up the pie. When he went into Czechoslovakia, he gave a piece to Poland. And when he went into Poland, he gave a piece to Russia. And he gave Russia the Baltic states. Hitler was always giving people things. He even gave the British something. He gave them a deal where his navy would only be 35% as big as the British navy, thereby screwing the French. He was an evil man, but he was a smart man.
Why did it take so long for the Allies to respond?
They didn't want war. Imagine if someone on television were to come on right now and say, let's go back to Vietnam. Let's go back. For whatever reason, people would say, I don't want to hear the reason. I'm not going back to Vietnam. And just realize that the Second World War, we're talking about the 1930s, mid-30s, just 17 years after the end of World War I, the worst war in history, where people were being killed by the thousands a minute in these attacks on trenches and gas, and people were scared to death of poison gas, and that terrible war. And there was only one man in the world that wanted to go back to war, and that was Hitler. And he played that desire for peace against people. Yes, it could have been avoided if people were willing to go to war, like Winston Churchill would have been willing to go to war in 1935 rather than 39. They could have wiped Hitler out in about 2 days. And Hitler had a battle plan, in fact, that when he made his first aggression against the Rhineland, his generals were under orders, if the French counterattack, we withdraw. In other words, he had nothing to fall back on. He had no military power. He was outnumbered 100 divisions to one. The French had 100 divisions in the field. He had one. But nobody wanted war except Hitler. In other words, the worst man in history got to define history, and that was the frightening thing.
But somehow, when Germany was in depression and when the Versailles Treaty that was in place that prohibited a buildup of an army, Hitler did it. He rearmed Germany.
That's right. He gave the people a future which was based on a delusion, which was they were the victims. And he kept telling the German people, we're surrounded. The Russians and the French are coming to get us. The Germans are being mistreated in the outlying countries. Everything was playing on that German paranoia, and he played it like a violin.
Chris Matthews, interesting discussion. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
It's 16 before the hour now. We'll be back. This week on CBS This Morning, country music star Katie Lang, actor Raymond Burr, and actress Martha Plimpton.
The fraternities at the University of Texas are picking new members this week, but this year the old tradition has a new twist. No alcohol. 3 years ago, during Rush Week, an 18-year-old freshman died of acute alcohol poisoning, and the move to stop the drinking has been building ever since in Austin. Across the country, the number of alcohol-related accidents and deaths of fraternity members is alarmingly high. Senior Cliff Freelink is the president of the Texas Interfraternity Council, and Paul Arlinghouse is a freshman who is taking part in Rush Week, and they join us this morning from Austin. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, Harry.
Good morning.
Cliff, let me ask you first, no alcohol. How come?
Well, it's a move we've finally gone to. We've been thinking about it ever since these accidents that have happened in the past. The fraternities have decided that it's a good move because the Rushies now go through Rush and choose which fraternity to join based on the brotherhood, the academics, community service, the things we're truly about, not just how much booze they can get.
When you all sat down with the Greek Council, was it a tough sell?
At first, everyone was real shocked by the suggestion, but we got a committee together of all the fraternities and their rush captains. They all talked about it together, and everybody wanted to make this move.
What are you doing to police the fraternities, though? I mean, it sounds good on the surface, but I find it very difficult to believe that there isn't back rooms with all, you know, booze flowing freely.
Right. We have every fraternity has provided two members, and we have a total of 69 members who are going around random spot checking fraternity houses. Even the patrolling members don't know where they're going when. We're also patrolling the area restaurants, even restaurants 30 minutes out of town, going to the lake, going everywhere, and making sure no one is drinking.
Paul, you're a freshman at the university, and you're interested in joining a fraternity. Have you been to any parties this week? Any social functions?
Social functions, going out. Last night I went out with the fraternity, went out to eat with them, and had a lot of fun.
Did you have any alcohol?
No, sure didn't. I have not had any alcohol during rush week.
I'm sure are talking with some of your buddies as well. Have any of them, or have you seen alcohol this week at all at any of these fraternity functions? And you got to be honest, because this can be held against you in court.
Yes, I am being honest when I say I have not seen any alcohol at any fraternity functions during formal rush week.
That's really quite amazing. Did you expect this when you went off to the university?
No, I sure didn't. You know, I heard a lot about rush week before I knew it was going to be dry rush week. And, you know, heard it's just a big party, a week full of parties with alcohol. And so, you know, I expected that. And it came as a surprise when I found out it was going to be dry rush.
Does it make a difference then as you choose what sort of fraternity you might be interested in?
I think it does. I think this way I get to know, you know, the guys in the fraternity a little better. You know, obviously we'll be sober and we are sober, and that I get to know them as people. And you know, as a rushie, I have to choose a fraternity based on, you know, lifelong friends. I'm going to know these guys, you know, yeah, 4 years and beyond.
What's been the reaction of some of the other rushies as they found out that there was not going to be any alcohol this week?
There have definitely been a lot of complaints about how boring it has been. You know, they really think there should be alcohol.
Interesting. Cliff, the ZBTs and the TEKs nationwide have made a decision to get rid of all pledging activities and all hazing activities. Do you think that's a trend that you might see down in Austin as well?
It's something everyone is looking into. My national fraternity, Delta Sigma Phi, is considering that option, but we're not sure about that yet. It's something that ZBT and TEK decided was a smart move, because hazing incidents have come up with different fraternities, but we're just making a big effort down here to eliminate hazing, and I think we've gotten pretty close to eliminating it down at the University of Texas, which is obviously a big statement. But I think there are other ways to do it, but those fraternities decided to take that approach.
Cliff, Paul, thank you very much for joining us this morning. Good luck, and hook 'em horns.
Thanks, Harry.
All right, good to see you. It's 9 minutes before the hour. Faith?
Next, a new band, a new tour, and a hot new album for Paul McCartney. McCartney fans will likely tell you that his latest album, Flowers in the Dirt, is one of his best. They're also excited about his upcoming tour. Tickets went on sale in this country yesterday and were sold out in less than 1 hour. I talked with McCartney and with his band member and wife, Linda, after a mini concert for the press.
It really feels nice to get out in front of an audience, and as long as it's not just too crazy, and as long as you're not just in, you know, 1,000 Holiday Inns in a week, then, which it isn't like that these days, then it can be quite good fun, really.
Linda McCartney played keyboards in his old group, Wings. She's back at it again in the new band.
I'm apprehensive, but I'm excited.
Did he have to twist your arm to get you out there?
Both arms.
Really?
And my legs, yeah.
Why?
It was fun.
Just because you didn't want to leave home?
Yeah. I'm very content at home. I like nature, and you're indoors a lot and traveling a lot when you're touring. But the band's wonderful, and Paul's out on the road and wonderful, so I'm getting into it.
Are you a worrywart? Will you stand in the background and worry about how he's doing and if he's getting overheated?
I worry a lot when he does things that I'm not in. They usually go, yeah, I do. I sort of look at people taking pictures, if they're the right angle. It's ridiculous. Not on me. I could care less.
They plan to return home in between dates to spend time with their four children.
I don't think we're like a showbiz family. I'm home a lot with the kids, and I relate, and I care about them, you know, and Paul's the same. Only he's a showbiz person.
Well, you're certainly not a showbiz couple in one other regard. You just had your 20th anniversary. That's a long time.
It's hard for anybody. You know, we have our ups and downs. But it beats the alternative, which is either splitting up or going with someone else. So far, we're still together.
The two will be carrying with them a public service message on the tour. They've invited the environmental group Friends of the Earth along to spotlight their concern about the environment.
I've got a feeling that if people make a really concerted effort over the next 10 years, we could be in a very different kind of civilization where we realize not to soil our own nest. You know, animals don't do that stuff. You know, they go somewhere else to do it, you know. But we do it. We're crazy.
People have to stand up and say, come on, guys, if you don't do something about it, you're the silent majority. Do something about it. And if our politicians don't do it, showbiz people, look at Live Aid. I mean, they're doing more than the politicians half the time. So, you know, that's why this tour for me is meaningful. Otherwise, I'm really just on an ego trip, I suppose, and who needs that?
People are going to be plenty excited to hear the new stuff, but for us oldies, the Beatles music is really just the best. He's going to be doing two songs, in fact, that he has never before been able to perform live. Do you know which two they would be?
No.
Take a guess.
I can't even begin to fathom in all
Sergeant Pepper's.
Yeah.
And Hey Jude. He's never done those live before. The group broke up before they ever performed them live.
That should be terrific.
Yeah. He's excited about doing them as well.
5 minutes before the hour, CBS This Morning continues.
On CBS This Morning, here's a look at your weather.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Tim Kelly in the Channel 6 Weather Center. We're going to have a gray day today, a couple of glimpses of sunshine, also some showers scattered about, 74 to 78. Tomorrow, we see the sun return during the afternoon.
Tomorrow, we're going to be hearing from a great country star from Canada, Katie Lang, and Raymond Burr is going to be telling us about his brand new TV series.
Still a lot ahead this morning as well. We'll be back in a moment.
Back to CBS This Morning. I'm Harry Smith.
And I'm Faith Daniels, in for Kathleen Sullivan.
In New York City, an ugly racial incident has raised tempers in a usually quiet Brooklyn neighborhood. Protests and confrontations like this one Sunday started after the shooting death of a black teenager by a group of whites in the predominantly white neighborhood. In just a couple of minutes, how community leaders are responding to the challenge of racism and violence. Also this half hour, danger for children from some unsafe cribs and why the government isn't doing anything about it.
If you're a parent, no doubt you've been through at least a few sleepless nights with your child. But believe it or not, it can become so serious that it can be called insomnia. Later on, we will find out how you can help your kids get a better night's sleep and, in the process, get a better night's sleep yourself. And recycling is sweeping the country this summer. If you want to get on the bandwagon, an expert will show us some practical ways to recycle. And actor Lorenzo Lamas of Falcon Crest is also a race car driver. This morning, he'll tell us about his part in trying to make young people better and safer drivers. First, though, the news, and here again with that is Barry Peterson. Barry?
Good morning, Harry and Faith, and good morning to all of you. This morning, an explosion of new violence in the Colombian drug war. A bomb blast ripped through a travel agency across from a military academy in Bogota. The explosion caused heavy damage, but no reported casualties. And there were half a dozen more bombings early today in the cocaine capital of Medellin. As Juan Vasquez reports, Colombian officials believe things will get worse before they get better.
Authorities are bracing for more violence if accused drug cartel money launderer Eduardo Martinez Romero is extradited to the United States. His extradition papers are in Bogota awaiting the signature of government ministers. While Colombia fights to cut the supply of cocaine, the country's leaders say the real answer to the problem is to reduce demand. President Virgilio Barco said in an appeal to the international community that the fugitive leaders of the cartel would set up business outside of this country as long as demand persists.
If not Colombia, then somewhere else will continue to be terrorized by drug cartels until people stop using these illegal drugs.
Meanwhile, drug fighters seized alleged cocaine trafficker Abraham Mahut as the search continued for leaders of the drug cartel. Colombian Justice Minister Monica de Grief met with U.S. Attorney General Richard Thornburg in Washington to discuss the Colombian situation, and Thornburg is scheduled to make a full report to President Bush today. Juan Vasquez, CBS News, Bogota.
President Bush will weigh his drug war options today at a cabinet-level strategy session in Kennebunkport, Maine. It will serve as a kind of a work break from the president's nonstop approach to relaxation. Yesterday, that included boating and golf and fending off reporters' questions about possible covert action inside Colombia.
If I discuss covert action, it wouldn't be covert. And I don't discuss that kind of thing at all anyway. So please don't take that answer as a yes or a no or a confirm or a deny.
There is no secret about the tightened security surrounding Florida Governor Bob Martinez these days. Martinez says federal agents warned him that Colombian drug lords are threatening to assassinate an American public official. And Martinez has been leading a campaign for a crackdown on the Colombian drug cartel. Syrian artillery hit a tanker off Beirut this morning and set it afire. The tanker, trying to run a Syrian blockade with desperately needed fuel for Lebanon's besieged Christians. Two crewmen rescued, nine are missing and feared dead. Christian gunners opened fire to try to protect rescue workers. That set off an artillery duel that killed at least three more people. Two very different views of one man at the Jim Bakker trial. Bakker's attorneys described the PTL founder as a creative religious genius. But Bruce Hall reports that prosecutors are portraying Bakker as a cheat with lavish tastes.
Prosecutor Jerry Miller told the jury the PTL founder Jim Bakker cheated his followers out of their money by telling untruths, half-truths, and concealed truths. Miller described Bakker as a man who used people and ministry funds to support an opulent lifestyle that included expensive cars for his children, who at the time were not even old enough to drive. But Bakker attorney George Davis said the minister was free to do whatever he wanted with millions in ministry funds, because they were sent as unrestricted donations by PTL members. Former PTL executive David Taggart testified that Bakker wanted to be paid the same as Johnny Carson, and that he kept more than $3 million in bonuses secret from the board of directors.
There was nobody looking over anybody's shoulder, and I think that was where some of the behind-the-scene plays came in.
In court, PTL was described as a closed society, with Jim Bakker in absolute control of all financial dealings. Prosecutors contend he was given regular reports showing that more lifetime partnerships were being sold than PTL hotels could accommodate.
Well, can you? Honey, this is for you today. Don't you dare give up. Hang in.
Bakker's wife is continuing to broadcast from a nearly empty shopping center in Orlando, but her pleas for money are falling on fewer and fewer ears, as less than a dozen stations are still carrying the program.
Jim and I have served the Lord for many years. He's never failed us, and I don't think he's going to let us down now.
Meanwhile, Jim Bakker is expected to spend the next month in court instead of on the airwaves. If convicted, he could face up to 120 years in prison.
Thank you.
Bruce Hall, CBS News, Charlotte.
Former Georgia Congressman Pat Swindall says he wants a new trial to reverse his perjury conviction. Swindall was sentenced yesterday to a year in prison and fined more than $30,000 for lying about a money laundering scheme. Outside the court, Swindall said his quarrel is not with the sentence, but with the trial and the verdict.
I am not at all disappointed in the judge's sentence. I think that anyone that is a public official who intentionally lies to any grand jury ought to serve time in jail. I think that a year is an appropriate punishment for anyone that does so.
You would rather have been...
Swindall remains free on his own recognizance pending appeal. Representative Barney Frank is calling for a congressional investigation of himself. Frank has admitted hiring a male prostitute for sex and later for errands and household chores. Frank's fellow Democrats in the House have been under pressure to get the House Ethics Committee to look into all that. By asking for the investigation himself, Frank takes the pressure off everyone else. Some of the items in our daybook this Tuesday, the 29th of August. A bitter race is decided by Florida voters today in a special election to fill the seat of the late Congressman Claude Pepper. The scientists behind the Voyager 2 mission hold one last news conference on Voyager's dramatic photos of Neptune. And blues guitarist B.B. King goes down in history today when his handprints are set in concrete on the Rock Walk of Fame in Hollywood. And Faith and Harry, can you say Rock Walk of Fame three times real fast?
No, but I can say Lucille. Thanks, Barry. Okay.
Time to check in on that weather once again. Here with that is Mark.
Thank you, Faith. You know all the pretty women, Harry. Lucille, B.B. King's guitar. Let's talk about the weather. Good morning, B.B., if you're out there watching, and I know you are. 69 degrees in New York City. I'm going to put this little guy up here. I'm going to put him in Canada, but you're going to see some fog in the Northeast this morning, and maybe a little bit throughout the day, so please be very careful of that, and take out your fog lights, put them on your forehead or something, but be forewarned. There's rain off the coast of New Jersey as we speak. There's rain entering portions of Pennsylvania and southern New York as we speak. It's not going to be a great day. We'll get to that in just a second. Lots of sevens down south and 80 down in Miami. Some rain off the coast of Louisiana, but there's also rain entering Illinois, Iowa. Portions of it's raining right now in Kansas City, also across the border of Nebraska and Oklahoma. Down in the southwest, not too much to talk about, but up in the northwest, not necessarily the Pacific Northwest, some cloud cover over Idaho, as you can see, and rain also in Anchorage and some clouds up in Fairbanks and 74 in Honolulu. Now, later on today, let's talk about it. It's going to be an overcast, muggy day in the northeast. Plenty of in the way of fog and showers throughout the afternoon. There just doesn't seem to be any break in those thunderstorms across the plains in the Midwest and the Central Plains. They continue to flare up, bring heavy rain from areas of New Mexico up into Kansas and into Iowa and Illinois. The heat's going to continue across the deep south. Look at those temperatures down there. Most places will see temps in the low 90s. The far southwest will be sunny and seasonably warm. That's a quick look at the national forecast. Let's take a look at your weather.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Tim Kelly in the Channel 6 Weather Center. We're going to have a gray day today. A couple of glimpses of sunshine. Also some showers scattered about. 74 to 78. Tomorrow we see the sun return during the afternoon.
Next time around, we'll talk about the weather for tomorrow. Faith?
All right, thanks, Mark. The Consumer Product Safety Commission has taken a lot of heat for being a do-nothing agency. Ironically, now that it's trying to take action, it finds its hands are tied. The latest example is crib safety. Consumer correspondent Aaron Moriarty is here with the story now. Good morning, Aaron.
Good morning, Faith. Let me give you a little bit of background. The specific problem involves corner posts on cribs. After nearly 50 deaths and serious injuries, the industry voluntarily took action in 1986 to eliminate the problem. But according to the Consumer Product Safety Commission, three more infants have died, and now one victim's family wants the government to step in. But the real problem goes beyond the victims and their families, and even beyond the question of crib safety.
This is Danny Lineweaver 5 years ago. This is Danny today. Brain damage after his clothing caught on a crib corner post and nearly strangled him to death.
I found him hanging from his corner post. His t-shirt had gotten entangled. And that moment was incredible as far as how could this happen.
2 years after Danny's accident, the industry reduced the height of crib corner posts. But since 1986, three more children have died. Now Danny's family is asking for a recall that could involve as many as 10 million new cribs and even more old ones.
These cribs are not like used cars. These things recycle into use periodically over generations. And they're just death traps lurking in someone's garage or attic.
We learned and continue to learn that this continues to happen. It'll make it mandatory for the crib manufacturers and anyone that's involved in making cribs to make safe cribs.
The Limeweaver's petition was filed with the Consumer Product Safety Commission, the federal agency that in recent years has come under fire for moving too slowly on safety issues. Acting Chairman Ann Graham admits cribs are a major concern.
Personally, I am concerned about it, but we haven't docketed the petition, and we're going to have to do the research to see if it warrants a recall.
But the government can't do anything about cribs right now, and that has more to do with the White House than the Consumer Product Safety Commission. After 7 months in office, President Bush has still not appointed a new commissioner to the agency, and without three commissioners, the agency can't act.
We can't do it without another commissioner. We're looking and we're optimistic that we'll have a quorum shortly. And as soon as we do that, I would add that I think that this petition is important enough that it be one of the first items on the agenda.
In the meantime, the commission can only order new recalls when the companies involved agree to them.
What you need to do with this one is cut off the plug and mail it back to the maker.
And publicize old recalls made when the commission still had the power.
And that concerns us. What kind of message does that send to industry when they know that the agency that has authority over them, that can force them to do something, really can't?
The crib industry representatives say that an informal agreement to eliminate corner posts altogether has already been reached. But in the past, when the manufacturers have voluntarily made a safety change, they've also given themselves plenty of time to implement it. So without government action, potentially dangerous cribs could stay on the market for years. And it's so ironic because finally the Consumer Product Safety Commission seems really interested in moving ahead. They've had more recalls that companies have agreed to than they've had in months and years.
So without the government, if you own one of these cribs that has a corner post on it, what do you do? Is this problem serious enough to throw the crib out, or if finances are a consideration, is there a way to alter it?
Well, if you can't afford to get another crib, you could, believe it or not, saw off any kind of corner post and then sand it down. You need to get rid of anything that could catch on child's clothing, and you shouldn't put anything around a child's neck. Believe it or not, one of the children who died had been wearing a necklace. You cannot do that and then stick a person in a crib because he can get caught on the edge.
And it's not just corner posts. I mean, it's the little kickstands at the bottom on the older models. It's mesh playpens. I mean, there are so many things out there that are potentially dangerous.
Well, I think that's one of the reasons why this family wants a recall of old cribs, too, because some of the old cribs that people get secondhand are very dangerous.
All right, Aaron, we are an interesting report. Thank you. It is 14 past the hour now. Harry?
Coming up next, black and white in New York City, the tension grows in Brooklyn. Racial tension is running high in New York City after the shooting death last week of a black teenager in the predominantly white Brooklyn neighborhood of Bensonhurst. The youth and some friends were in Bensonhurst to buy a car when they were confronted by about 30 whites with baseball bats and a gun. Since then, there have been marches protesting the shooting and proclaiming the right of anyone to go anywhere in New York. The marchers have been met by jeering, name-calling whites who told the protesters to stay out of Bensonhurst. The march on Sunday was led by the Reverend Timothy Mitchell. He's the pastor of the Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church in Queens, New York, and he joins us this morning, along with the Reverend Charles Famiglia, a Roman Catholic priest at St. Dominic's Church in Bensonhurst. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Father, I've got to ask you first. You know some of these.
Announced to the nation 1 week from today. Yesterday, the President and Mrs. Bush hosted Labor Secretary Elizabeth Dole and her husband, Senate Minority Leader Bob Dole. They reported on their visit to Poland, Morocco, and Soviet Armenia. Soviet President Gorbachev is reported to have been on the phone long distance to the Baltics, telling the pro-independence forces there to cool it. One pro-independence activist in Lithuania says Gorbachev's message was, "Don't even think about breaking away from the Soviet Union." Acting President F.W. de Klerk has ended a trip north. De Klerk met with Zambia's President Kaunda, part of a South African effort to gain some diplomatic influence in black Africa. But there was no talk of dismantling apartheid. And in Pretoria, South Africa yesterday, blacks taking part in the national campaign of defiance were prevented from boarding whites-only buses. An electrical fire forced the evacuation of Chicago's Drake Hotel overnight. An explosion in an electrical vault caused a blackout in the hotel and a four-square-block area around it. Hotel guests were allowed to return to their rooms after about 4 hours. No one hurt, but five firefighters treated for smoke inhalation. It is day two of TV preacher Jim Bakker's fraud trial in Charlotte, North Carolina. Bakker faces federal charges of diverting millions from the PTL empire to pay for expensive homes and cars and lavish vacations. While Jim Bakker is in court, his wife, Tammy Faye, is keeping up the couple's TV show and offering her support.
Honey, this is for you today. Don't you dare give up. Hang in.
Bakker is charged with 28 counts of fraud and conspiracy and faces up to 120 years in prison. The Commerce Department has revised its second quarter figures for the gross national product. Figures out this morning show that from April through June, the economy's total output of goods and services was up 2.7%. Some good news, Faith and Harry. Back to you.
See, gross national product as opposed to the non-gross national product. Thanks very much, Barry.
We have time to look ahead to tomorrow as far as the weather is concerned. Here again, Mark.
Thank you. As opposed to the yucky national product. A couple of birthdays today. Entertainer extraordinaire Michael Jackson with the moonwalk. Michael is 31 years old. Elliot Gould is 51. And one of cinema's greatest actresses, Ingrid Bergman, was born on this date back in 1915. Woo! She was a great actress. Boom, let's talk about the weather. You can see up in the northeast today, a little rain activity right around portions of Pennsylvania. Also, New York and New England is going to see a little rain. We're going to see some showers off and on in New York City. Once you get past that rain, you can see warmth. A lot of warmth down in the south. Lots of nines across the map. And scattered showers, rain down through the south, and also rain extending from right behind me, which is New Mexico, all the way up through portions of the Midwest and the Central Plains, all the way up, into, as you can see, into the southern area of the Great Lakes. So you get out to the west, 108 for Phoenix today. Hop across the front, you see a little rain in Northern California and 75 up in Seattle. Now for tomorrow, beautiful days in store for the Great Lakes. That nice weather is going to be pushing across the northeast, heading this way before the day gets too long. Thunderstorms will be rumbling across southern sections of the Ohio and Tennessee valleys. In the heat of the afternoon, parts of the deep south could see a brief dousing, which will at least deliver some relief to the hot weather. Northern Rockies could get some showers tomorrow. The southwest will remain nice and sunny. That's a quick look at the national forecast. Let's take a look at your weather.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Tim Kelly in the Channel 6 Weather Center. We're going to have a gray day today, a couple of glimpses of sunshine, also some showers scattered about, 74 to 78. Tomorrow, we see the sun return during the afternoon.
That's the weather for today and for tomorrow. Faith?
Thanks, Mark. It's 24 before the hour. Next, short of pulling out your hair, what to do when your child can't sleep.
This morning's health segment is sponsored by Advil for headaches, muscle aches, fever, backaches. Advil.
Sleeping like a baby brings to mind the image of easy, restful sleep, but the old cliche isn't always true. In fact, one quarter of all infants and children suffer from insomnia at one time or another. Dr. Richard Ferber is the director of the Center for Pediatric Sleep Disorders at Children's Hospital in Boston, and he joins us live from Boston this morning. Good morning, Dr. Ferber.
Good morning.
When you bring an infant home from the hospital, should parents expect that baby sleep through the night right away?
Well, absolutely not. I think everybody would expect the child's going to be up during the night. The youngster has to feed, of course, and the underlying rhythms that control sleep take a little while to develop. Most children start to sleep through by around 3 or 4 months, and I think that we can expect that pretty much all children can be sleeping quite well at night by 5 or 6 months.
But there are incredible numbers of people out there who say, "Doctor, I hear what you're saying, but that's not true at my house."
That's right. I think that's the most common problem that we deal with at our center.
And initially, for infants, for instance, about the time that they should be sleeping through the night, what kinds of problems are parents encountering, and what can they do about it to get that child to sleep through the night?
Well, I think the first thing to understand is that there's really a lot of different reasons that young children will have problems at night. And the first thing that one has to do is to try to identify the specific problem that's causing difficulties for your child. Then you can go about making the changes. For example, the most common problem of all actually is one that is perceived incorrectly. We may have a child, let's say, who seems to go to sleep okay, and the complaint is that they wake up a lot during the night, and the family sees the wakings as abnormal, and they try to do something to help treat these wakings.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it turns out that these wakings are just a normal part of sleep cycling across the night. They're wakings that we have throughout life. And the problem is that the youngster, instead of just turning over and going back to sleep, as we usually do, wakes up and all the way and cries until somebody comes in and does something. And that's really the crux of the problem. It's not that the waking is the issue, it's what the situation is that exists when the child goes to sleep. And for example, if he has learned to go to sleep when being held, rocked, walked about, having his back patted, or even driven around the block, and if that's the way he's put down at bedtime, that when he wakes up a few hours later, he or she may have difficulty going back to sleep until somebody comes in and does the same thing all over again.
Because what pains parents is when they hear that child crying in the middle of the night. They don't know, should they go in and respond to that in some way, what the response should be, or whether they should, you know, their mother says, leave the kid alone, he'll fall back to sleep again.
Well, I think that probably none of those are the best advice, and I think that if that specific problem that I just described is the issue, in other words, the child wakes up a couple of times at night and you can do something very quickly to get them back to sleep, then I think you can be pretty sure that helping them learn to go to sleep a new way will solve the problem. And I try to help the youngsters learn this in a more gradual way. For instance, you have to say, what's the situation going to be like when they wake up at night? And that's the way you want them to learn to go to sleep. And if that means being in a crib by themselves, without being held and rocked, then that's what you teach them. And it's a good idea, after you're finished with the nightly routines, to put them down awake and then leave the room. And if that is upsetting to the child, to go back to reassure them, but to keep stretching those intervals out and to continue to do that until they fall asleep. And if they wake up at night, to go and do it the same way, stretching those intervals out, mm-hmm. always letting them fall asleep in the same way they woke up. And what's very, very nice is that young children learn extremely rapidly. So as it may take us weeks and months to learn a new way of sleeping at night, in these early months, these children learn this within a couple of nights. And so generally, we're only talking about 2-3 nights before they're sleeping quite well.
Dr. Ferber, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Okay, my pleasure.
We'll scribble down those tips. It's 19 minutes before the hour, Faith.
My pencil's out of lead at this point. Next, the fine art of recycling. An expert shows us how it's done.
People more aware of our environmental crisis, recycling is a hot issue this summer. 1,000 U.S. communities already have recycling programs. Well, it might be hot, but to many Americans, recycling is also a pain in the neck, at least. Don't despair. David Goldbeck has some help. He is a lawyer turned food writer and the author of Smart Kitchen. And he joins us now live from his own kitchen in Woodstock, New York. Good morning.
Good morning.
Is this an indication, or have you come up with a way for people to stop fighting the problems of recycling and sort of join the revolution?
Well, I think I can make it easier. There's no question that recycling is part of our life. You know, I put on my dinner jacket this morning to remind people that we're recycling all the time. We rent tuxedos, and that's recycling. People pass baby clothes around. That's a form of recycling. And, you know, antiques are an elegant form of recycling. And I think design, particularly in the kitchen, because that tends to be the recycling center, could just make this new fact of life a lot easier.
Well, show us around a little bit, because you have really planned your kitchen out in a way that is designed to make recycling a lot easier. Show us what you've done.
Well, we call this a demonstration kitchen, and what we've done is put four different systems in the kitchen to show how it could be made easier. And this is one of the most basic, is just to take a large drawer and to use supermarket brown bags, and using the amount of bags you need depending on whatever your recycling center takes back. I mean, here we have glass, plastic, and cans, which is the most common. Some places I want you to segregate aluminum as well, and we also keep some extra brown bags in here. And the nice part about it is you've got it sorted out, very easy. Staple the bags closed, put them in the trunk of your car or your garage, wherever you hold them. I'll put them on the curb, depending on the system. And the nice part about it is you can just make this go away. But it makes it very easy just putting it in
the
drawer.
How about the messy stuff? What do we do with the messy stuff?
Well, the messy stuff, what I did is, you know, a lot of people have been composting for years, and they very often put it in a jar up on their counter, and they get tired of looking at yesterday's dinner turn green. So what I did is I built a through-the-counter compost system, a very clean system. We just prepare our food here, throw the waste in, this little plastic cover slides closed. Depending on the season, sometimes it smells, then we dump it out. And the way I keep bugs from